Everyone, good to see you here. If you're visiting, we're especially thankful that you have come our way and joined with us in worship and fellowship this morning. It does look like either a lot of people are out of town or we're going to have a really big 10:30 service. I'm not sure how that always works out, but we're glad for each one of us that's here at the early service this morning. Excuse me. Last week, we studied about praising God because He created us and everything in the world. You remember that for that lesson, we started at the very beginning, which is a very good place to start. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Genesis 1, verse 1 is a good reason, an excellent reason for praising God. We live only because God made us and sustains us. This morning, we're going to start at the very end, which is also a very good place to start. But by very end, I'm not referring to the book of Revelation, but to the crucifixion of Jesus. And of course, I understand that the very end is the gospel accounts is the resurrection, but the crucifixion is very near to the end. But our theme is not that we should praise God because Christ died on the cross, although that is an excellent reason for praising God. That's just not where we're going this morning. We're going to end up looking at something other than the crucifixion, but that's where we need to start. We start with the crucifixion. We all know that when Jesus was crucified, He was not alone. There were three crucifixions that day. According to Matthew chapter 27, verse 38, two robbers were crucified with Him, one on the right and another on the left. We aren't Christians today because two robbers were crucified that day. We don't observe the Lord's Supper to remember either of those men. In fact, when we observe the Lord's Supper, I'm going to guess that we almost totally disregard the other two crosses. We generally don't even mention them in our table talks, for example. They are nothing to us. But yet they had moms and dads and maybe wives and kids. They were human beings created in the image of God. Since they were crucified by Romans in Jerusalem, there's also a good chance that they were Jews, just like Jesus. The soldiers may have gone back to their barracks that night and felt satisfied that they had eliminated three troublesome Jews from the city. The job of keeping peace and order in Palestine would be made easier because these three men were gone. We certainly don't praise God because Jesus had company on the cross. What made His crucifixion different? Sometimes we might even imagine that He was nailed to the cross and that the two robbers were probably attached in a more humane and less painful way than He was. But there's no reason to think that, if that's what we think. There were three crucifixions, and they were probably all done in more or less the same way. The crucifixion of Jesus was different because of who was crucified. The other crucifixions were carried out that day. They were just ordinary crucifixions because the two robbers were not Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The key to that isn't things like that the miracles that Jesus did, He did miracles that no one else could match. Yes, His miracles were amazing and they testify to who He was. But we don't serve Jesus today and we don't praise God because the greatest miracle worker who ever lived had been crucified. The teachings of Jesus, all by themselves, without even the theological implications, provide a moral compass that will enrich the lives of anyone who will live according to those teachings. We are blessed more than we can know by the wisdom of the teachings of Jesus. From the Beatitudes to love your neighbor as yourself to go and sin no more, The teachings of Jesus are as good as any body of teachings we could ever find. But the crucifixion of Jesus was not the pivot point of history because a great teacher was hanging on the middle cross. The crucifixion was special because of events that had occurred some 33 years earlier. Today, popular culture would call that the Christmas story. But the word Christmas doesn't cover everything that it needs to cover. The word nativity is maybe a little bit better, but it's still not enough. Now, those aren't inappropriate words that we should never use, but the message of those words doesn't go far enough to explain why the crucifixion of Jesus was what it was and did what it did. The word that we need to keep in mind is the word incarnation. The word incarnation, often with a capital I, refers to the idea that Jesus was God coming to earth in the flesh. And this idea is addressed a bit differently in each of the four Gospels. Mark, for example, doesn't have what is often called a nativity story. Mark skips the birth of Jesus and starts directly with the ministry of John the Baptist, followed by the ministry of Jesus. In other words, Mark starts directly when those two men were adults. Matthew and Luke each have a nativity story, but they tell it from a different angle with complementary details. John approaches it in his own unique way, and we're going to look at the presentations of Matthew, Luke, and John as we work through our lesson this morning. All three of them, but John especially, wants us to understand that the story they tell about the arrival of Jesus is more than a mere birth story. To go back to the line of thought from just a moment ago, the crucifixion wasn't a world-changing event because it killed a man who had been born. That's sort of an obvious thing. It was not the simple fact of birth that distinguishes the crucifixion of Jesus from that of the two robbers. They were all three at one time cute little babies loved by their mamas. And it's important for us to remember that the birth of Jesus was more than just the start of a man's life on earth. We all were born. We all had a birth story that started our earthly existence. But as we read the gospel story, and especially when we get to the crucifixion, we have to remember that there was something amazingly different about this particular birth story. The virgin birth of Jesus is more than a required belief of Christians that we can then more or less forget once we have acknowledged that it happened and that it's true. Let me give a hint of where I'm going with this, but I'm not quite ready to really go there. For example, we acknowledge that Jesus lived a perfect, sinless life. This is stated explicitly in Hebrews 4, verse 15, and we'll probably come back to that verse a little later. But as exceptional as a perfect, sinless life would be, that would not be enough to make the crucifixion what it was. We're going to start by looking at John's introduction to the life and ministry of Jesus in John, the first chapter. John's introduction is normally called, or often called, the prologue, and it includes the first 18 verses of the Gospel of John. In verse 19, you get to the narrative about the work of John the Baptist, and then down around verse 35 and following, you're in the narrative of the work of Jesus when he invites disciples to literally follow him. And from there, the rest of the story is told. But the first 18 verses are really an introduction that give us a doctrinal as much as historical foundation for the whole story that follows. In John's introduction, We don't read about a baby being born, placed in a manger. We don't even read explicitly about a baby being born to a virgin. Those details, which are important, as we're going to see, those are left to Matthew and Luke to present. Matthew and Luke will back up a bit and tell about Mary and Joseph being told several months in advance about what was going to happen that would lead to the birth of Jesus. But John backs up a little bit farther. In fact, John backs up so far that he is able to borrow the first line of Genesis. John starts in the beginning. And John actually fills in details that Genesis 1 leaves out. John starts, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him nothing was made that was made." We don't get to the birth part of the story for several verses yet. John doesn't use the word son for several verses yet. John doesn't even bring a man into the text until verse 6, and that man won't be Jesus. The man of verse 6 is actually John the Baptist, who came to prepare the way for Jesus. John starts with God and something about God called the Word. The Word was both with God and the Word was God. Now, John is getting pretty lofty here. We don't understand this fully because the nature of God is beyond our understanding. But John is telling us something about the man Jesus, whom he won't mention by name even until verse 17, and he won't actually bring into the story until verse 29. But he's telling us something about Jesus that prepares us to meet someone who is fundamentally unlike anyone else. In the beginning, when creation started, the Word was already there. The Word is, in fact, the creator of everything that was created. Even if we can't fully take in who the Word is, we can understand that He is our creator, who is God. But so far, we have God with His Word, off wherever they are, creating the heavens and the earth and us. And then verse 14 brings in the element that puts a different twist on everything that will follow in the gospel story, including the crucifixion. The Word became flesh and lived among men. John 1, verse 14 is John's nativity story. But as I said earlier, nativity doesn't do it justice. John is telling us about incarnation. Jesus is the Word of God, born in fleshly form to live on earth as we do. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. In the place of the word begotten, in the New King James, some translations use the word son and they use it here for the first time in verse 14. Some have both words, begotten son. When the Word who was in the beginning came to earth, He was born to live on earth rather than just dropping down for a little visit. This feature is more evident in Matthew and Luke. So let's turn over to those Gospels. We'll start with Matthew. Matthew and Luke tell what sounds more like a normal birth story than John does, but even they make sure that we understand that it isn't really normal. Matthew starts with a genealogy and then gets into the birth story. Where Matthew picks up the story, Mary is already showing. Matthew 1:18-19. Now the birth of Jesus was as follows. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not wanting to make her a public example, was minded to put her away secretly. Joseph is perplexed. He's no fool, but he is also a kind and gentle man. He doesn't want to shame Mary publicly, but at the same time, he doesn't intend to marry a woman who is pregnant with someone else's child. And this is when God sent an angel to explain the situation to Joseph. Verse 20 of Matthew 1. But when he thought about these things, while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. This is where we have to make sure that we are really paying attention. This is more than the announcement of a church doctrine called the virgin birth. The danger is that we will take note of the idea and then forget about it for the rest of the story. This is Matthew's version of John 1:14, and the Word became flesh and lived among us. Now, all of this is fascinating and intriguing for us. It was probably that and more for Mary and Joseph. For some reason, it wasn't enough to send Jesus to earth in a way similar to various angel visits that we read about at various points in Scripture. And he couldn't just pop out of the wilderness when he wanted to start his ministry. But at the same time, it wasn't enough to just have a very good boy grow up to be a very good man who would give his life to help others. The Spirit of God fathered a human child so that the Word of God could come to earth and accomplish a unique mission. Luke's account of the birth story is similar to Matthew's, but Luke focuses a bit more on Mary, less on Joseph. At least God gave Mary a heads up before she realized that she was pregnant. But the message was about the same as in Matthew, though more explicit. In Luke chapter 1, verse 35, and the angel answered and said to her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the highest will overshadow you. Therefore, also, that the Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. The Holy Spirit is involved, the power of the highest is involved, and the result is that the ordinary-looking child that they will wrap in swaddling clothes and lay in a manger will actually be the Son of God. In both Matthew and Luke, other events happened in connection with the birth of this child to emphasize the special nature of it. There's the miraculous story of several things going on around the birth of John the Baptist that prepared the way for Jesus. There's a host of angels that appeared to some shepherds, and they praised God because this special child was born. There are a man named Simeon and a woman named Anna who were inspired by the Holy Spirit to recognize the baby as the fulfillment of prophecies. And when we take Matthew and Luke and John together, we see that they were each one emphasizing that the Jesus birth story was more than the beginning of an extraordinary individual and an extraordinary life. Many amazing and supernatural things accompanied his birth, but even the amazing circumstances were overshadowed by the true identity of the child. The how was impressive, but the who was even more impressive. Throughout the ministry of Jesus, the miracles of Jesus were never an end in themselves. The miracles were always used to reveal who he was. That's what Peter preached in Acts 2:22. He said, Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs. Jesus didn't come to earth to do miracles. He came to earth to die for our sins. But it was important that we know who it was who died. So in Philippians chapter 2, Paul spells out the link between the incarnation and the crucifixion. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8. But let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. We miss something if we read about the crucifixion and think only about how horrible it was. We must also keep in mind who it was who was suffering all of those horrible things. The man on the cross was not just a very good man, and he was not just a great miracle worker, and he was not just an exceptional teacher. He was God, who humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. The sacrifice of Jesus didn't begin when he was arrested in Gethsemane. The sacrifice of Jesus began when he didn't insist on being God in heaven, but took the form of a servant and came in the likeness of men on earth. It was horrible to be the Son of God and suffer the horrors of a crucifixion, certainly. But as the Word who created all that exists, it wasn't much fun either to be a helpless infant born in a stable and be totally dependent on sinful humans in order to feed him and care for him and change his diaper. Earlier I mentioned Hebrews 4:15 that says that he was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Have you ever dreamed about how great it would be if instead of having to resist temptations, with the potential, of course, of yielding to temptations, that we were immune to temptation? Well, James 1:13 says that God cannot be tempted. When he came in the flesh, he accepted temptation as a way of life. He accepted all the struggles of resisting temptation. That too was a sacrifice. It's the incarnation that makes the whole gospel story work. We read in the Bible of times when God sent angels to earth to pass along messages to humans. He could have gone one step farther and sent his Son to pass along some messages. He could teach us how to live and then go back to heaven. But that wasn't enough. It was necessary for God to send his Son to endure the entire human experience. He had to be born, grow to maturity, go through adolescence. He had to overcome the power of temptation. He had to deal with our ultimate enemy, which is death. It was necessary that it be God's own Son who did that. Because he was God's Son, he knew even before he started how unpleasant the whole experience would be. And he did it anyway. So the manger in Bethlehem can be appreciated and understood only in connection with the cross, and the cross can only be appreciated and understood in connection with the manger in Bethlehem. That's why the cross in the middle was different from the other two. Two of the crosses held men, the son of a father and a mother. The third cross held a man who was the son of a mother and of God. God is worthy to be praised because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and lived among us. Once we accept the truth of the Incarnation, also known as the doctrine of the virgin birth, the rest of the gospel story comes easy. God in the flesh doing miracles doesn't defy reason. God rising from the dead seems almost inevitable. God dying on a cross is more challenging, but when you include the perfect love of a perfect God who dies to save us, even that makes sense. We praise God not only for what was done on the cross, but for who did it. The Word who was with God and who was God. John uses that term begotten Son only four times in his gospel. He uses it twice in the prologue where the subject is the Word becoming flesh, and the other two times are in John 3, verses 16 and 18, where the subject is the begotten Son giving His life to save ours. God didn't sacrifice someone to save us. He sacrificed His own Son who had been with Him since before the beginning. It should not surprise us then that God holds us accountable for our response to such a sacrifice. We must believe that the baby in the manger and the man on the cross was God's Son. We must renounce the sins that made the whole thing necessary. We must be baptized as a symbolic act of dependence on God's grace to save us. If you want to respond to the gospel today, if you need to renew your commitment to serving Christ in all things, let us know while we stand, while we sing.